auntie that owns everything.
Hello.
Hello.
Doris phoned to say you were on your way.
As long as you get us a good picture on Channel 5, I can forgive anything. Hello. Hello.
So have you been to the house, or are you on your way there?
No fooling you, is there? I was on my way there. But now I don't know if I really want to see it.
Why do I have to go? Peter and I have plans for the summer holiday.
Oh, we've explained all this to you, Tom. Peter's very ill. You don't want to have the measles too, do you?
We'll take good care of him, Alice.
Yes, we're glad to help.
It'll be good practice for when we have our own.
Oh, the doctor said he wasn't to get out of bed. Now, Tom, remember, you'll be a visitor. Do try to be good.
We can climb the cathedral tower one day if you like, Tom.
Could we climb it now?
Not while you're in quarantine for business.
We'll climb it one day. One day soon.
I trust Tom will get on reasonably well.
Yes, Uncle Alan.
There's not much for you to do at our flat, I'm afraid. No children your age, no garden to play in. But we'll make the best of it.
We're here, Tom. This house was something in its day. Split up into flats some time ago.
Ours is on the first floor.
No, don't touch that, Tom. It belongs to the landlady upstairs. She's rather particular about it.
If she's so particular about it, then why does she leave it there?
Clock screwed to the wall.
My sister's eldest. There won't be any running about, will there?
My nerves just can't cope with running about.
He's a very quiet boy, Mrs. Willows, I assure you. No, it's not worth your while going out the back, Tom. There's no garden, just the rubbish bins.
Seldom strikes the correct hour, I'm afraid.
What good is the old thing, then?
Well, keeps good time.
Where the landlady lives, Mrs. Bartholomew. We're home. This is the living room. Come and see your bedroom, Tom.
This is a nursery. I'm not a baby.
No, of course you're not, Tom. Well, the room, it came like this.
The bathroom window has bars on it as well, Tom.
We'll leave you to unpack, settle in. Then it'll be tea time. You might like to ride home. Tell them you arrived safely.
Thank you, Uncle. I hope your measles are better. This is a picture of the cathedral at Ely. The house here is flat and there isn't any garden. My bedroom window has bars, but Aunt Gwen says it's a mistake. Tom. Long.
You may read in bed for 10 minutes.
Tom, no longer.
Just rubbish bins. They lied to me. I'm very sorry. Do you believe lying is wrong?
Of course, Tom.
Always?
Always.
So it's never justifiable?
Never.
Suppose someone was kept in the dark about something. Something he'd enjoy because some people didn't want to tell him about it. Suppose the other person went so far as to say the thing wasn't there in order not to have the bother of the first person using it.
What kind of thing was it that the second people didn't want the first people to know about?
But I think it really matters what the thing is, Gwen. If I understand Tom correctly, the point is that some person or persons were lying simply for their own convenience and to the harm of another person or persons.
That's exactly, Uncle Alan. I was wondering if you thought that that kind of lying might be right. I just wondered.
Of all possible forms of lying, Tom, that is surely the least justifiable.
Uncle Alan has a very highly developed sense of right and wrong. I'm sure you will too one day.
when you're grown up.
I have one now. It's other people who haven't.
You're the boy from the first floor front, the Kitsons. A bit dull for you around here, isn't it?
Yes. Do you live on the ground floor back flat?
I do at that.
Do you have a maid?
Do I look the type to have a maid?
No.
It's old Ma Bartholomew coming down to wind her precious clock. You don't want to run into her. There's never been children around here, and she wouldn't like it. Only 12 hours after all.
Thank you.
Dear Peter, something incredible has happened. You'll never believe it. I spend hours and hours in the garden. At least, it seems like that. But when I get back, it's only a few minutes later. I thought I could go anywhere in the garden, but it's not like that. I found a way to do things, though. An extraordinary discovery.
Bloody hell. For all good things I thank the Lord. May he keep me from all the works of the devil, that he hurt me not.
Not unless you put the clock back.
So, a tree could not be, like, fallen at one time and then standing up again, as it was before it fell. Unless you put the clock back.
That's exactly correct.
What clock?
Oh, no particular clock, Tom. It's just a saying. It means to have the past again. No one can have that. Time isn't like that.
Tom?
Yes, thank you.
You looked as if you were shivering, as if you caught a chill. I hope it's not the onset of measles. That would mean you staying away from home for several weeks longer instead of only 10 days.
Only 10 days?
You must be dying to get home.
I think I do have a temperature, and that it is measles.
No, you've no temperature. No temperature, no measles.
That's a relief. For you, I'm sure. Home soon.
From me. Oh, you silly little juggins. Come on. What will Aunt say?
Why did you fall then? Oh, I'll think of something to tell Mother. But now I'm off with the others. You'll stop crying though.
Have you seen my cousins?
They've been playing hide and seek with you again, miss.
It's the only game they ever play with me.
Why don't you ask them to let you do the hiding and them the seeking for a change?
If they did, they wouldn't find me easily. I can hide better than they do. I know more secret places.
Do you know, Miss Hattie?
It can be so quiet that nobody would even know I'm in the garden at all.
Can you know?
I can see everybody. And nobody can see me.
Play another game.
Yes, but this time Hattie sits it out. She doesn't play by the rules.
Can I have an apple, please?
Only if you play by the rules.
You keep changing the rules.
That's because you're too dense to keep up. How dare you stick your tongue out at us, Hattie?
My tongue was hot, and I wanted to cool it off.
Don't give pert, lying answers.
Let her be.
Yes, we'll let her be, James. We'll let her be all alone.
Thank you.
seen you watching me and following me. I saw you when Susan was dusting and when you waved from the tree. I saw you when you went right through the orchard door. I saw you when you never knew it. Who are you?
I'm Tom. Tom Long. I know your name. It's Hattie.
Princess Hattie, if you please. You may kiss my hand.
I don't want to kiss your hand. If you're a princess, then your father and mother must be king and queen. Where are they?
I'm not allowed to say. I'm held a prisoner here. There's someone here who calls herself my aunt, though she isn't so. She's wicked and cruel to me. And those boys you saw, they aren't really my cousins, although I'm forced to call them that. Now you know my whole secret. I'll permit you to call me princess, and I will allow myself to play with you.
Postcard. I can't really describe everything in the garden. I can tell you what the garden looks like, but I can't explain what it feels like. I mean to ask Hattie questions about the garden and everything, but somehow I always forget. Did you get it?
Susan always caught me, though. I always wanted to play bow and arrows. But my cousin said that I was too young. Then when I was older, they said that they were too old.
You made this, Miss Hattie?
All by myself.
Ah, but who taught you to do it?
Someone.
Well, whoever it was taught you, take care he don't teach you trouble with it.
Trouble? How could there possibly be trouble? I left the gate open.
How she came here unbeknownst is more than I know. Unless the devil himself drew her.
I wager Hattie let the old thing in.
Harriet! Why is it there is little doubt you are to blame for this? Must I remind you, Harriet, that I received you into my home as a duty to my late husband?
No, you don't need to remind me.
As a child of charity, I would expect you to be grateful.
I am grateful.
Are you, Harriet?
Yes, Aunt Melbourne.
And are you obedient?
Yes, Aunt Melbourne.
Show me. To your room instantly.
Come on, girl.
Thank you.
Don't cry. What are you crying for?
For my real home. My mother. For my father. They're dead. I don't want to be here.
Hattie?
Please leave me alone. I just want to be left alone.
Strange things happen in the garden, Peter. I've seen Hattie as a very little girl. Very unhappy. Crying. And it makes me sad to see it. Sadder, I think, than I've ever been.
I'm sorry our outing's ruined.
Can't we still climb the tower? I don't mind the rain.
They close the tower in weather like this.
Well, you shouldn't have to go home tomorrow.
You haven't caught a cold, have you? Well, if he has got a cold, he certainly can't go home. Not with Peter just getting over the measles.
No, you're right, of course. We'll telephone your sister and say that Tom must stay a little longer.
Mm.
Did Mr. Bartholomew always own this house?
Oh, Mr. Bartholomew never even lived in this house. Mrs. Bartholomew came here as a widow. And that wasn't many years ago.
But what about the clock in the hall? You said Mrs. Bartholomew owned it. But the clock has always been in this house.
Now, why do you suppose that? Come to think of it, that clock must have been here for some time, because the screws at the back have rusted into the wall. Oh, I imagine Mrs. Bartholomew must have bought the clock along with the house. It's all very straightforward when you reason it out, isn't it?
I suppose so. What's it like, I wonder, to be dead and a ghost?
You tell me.
I'm not a ghost.
Don't be silly, Tom. You forget. I saw you walk right through the orchard door.
I'm not a ghost. That's just the point. The orchard door is. The garden is. You are.
Indeed, I'm not. You are, and a silly little ghost you make, those clothes of yours.
These are my pyjamas, my best visiting pyjamas. And this is my bedroom slipper.
And why do you always wear just one? Is that the fashion nowadays? Of course it's not, because you are a ghost.
I'm glad you're better. Try as I might, I can't seem to get any real answers out of Hattie. The more time I spend with her, the more confused I get. Peter, I'm learning that girls can be very emotional. And sometimes, when they cry, you find yourself saying any old rubbish just to get them to stop. I need to find out more about Hattie. I need to find out everything about her. But time is running out. Bloody hell.
You look through the yellow one, and it seems to drench everything in lemonade.
This one makes it look like night. You can't really see anything through the star.
Sometimes I like that best of all. You look through the star and see nothing. You might think that there wasn't a garden there at all. But all the time, of course, there is one. Waiting for you. This is my favourite tree in the garden. It's the hardest one to climb. I call it Trixie. See what I've carved here? This means Hattie Melbourne has climbed this tree.
Carve my name too. That means Tom Long has climbed this tree with you.
We'll always be here, won't it, Tom?
Always. Always and always.
I wonder what's on the other side of that wall.
I'm going to climb that wall and find out.
No, Tom, that wall's far too high.
I
What do you see, Tom? What do you see beyond the garden?
You can see the river, and if you follow the river with your eye, you can see the cathedral at Ely. And beyond that...
Yes, beyond. Kneel down and swear on the Bible that I would never climb the wall. So high, he says, so dangerous.
Why would he think you would?
He saw me looking up. Perhaps he heard me talking to you.
No, your voice was too soft. And he couldn't have heard me. He couldn't have seen me.
I don't know, but he seemed so...
Angry?
Frightened.
Oh, I'm afraid you're going to have to stay indoors again, Tom. Well, we don't want you catching another cold, do we?
I suppose not.
Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you, Tom. All the time you've been here, and it looks as if we might never get to climb the cathedral tower.
Mrs. Kitson? I thought we had an understanding.
I'm sorry, I don't know what you mean, Mrs. Willis.
No running about. We agreed. No running about.
We weren't running about. We were just climbing the stairs. And rather quietly, I'd say.
I don't mean now. I mean at night. Every night, there are footsteps.
Oh, and exactly at what time do you hear these footsteps?
Midnight. Every night at midnight, when the clock strikes, footsteps running down the stairs, across the hall, out the back, then right away, back again.
But surely you're not suggesting that Tom... Well, he's safely tucked in bed at midnight, aren't you, Tom?
Yes, Aunt Gwen. You see, a boy my age needs 10 hours sleep.
I know running about when I hear it.
I wouldn't climb the wall. I didn't say anything about this tree. This is to be a proper house. It must have windows, not just accidental gaps in the walls.
You expect too much.
I hope I always shall.
Hattie!
Get you gone! Get you back to hell where you come from. I know you. I've seen you always, and heard you, and thought best to seem deaf, but I've known you for what you are, the devil!
Please, is Hattie, is she alive or dead?
You've tried to kill her often enough. Her that had neither a mother nor father nor home here. Nothing but her innocence against your devilry. May the Lord keep me from all the works of the devil, that he hurt me not.
In. Hattie!
Abel? What's happened? James! Fetch the doctor!
Abel, please. How is Hattie? She's not dead, is she?
No. She's alive.
Mother?
Come in, James.
James!
How's Hattie?
Hattie will do well enough.
Is that what the doctor says?
Yes.
We must be thankful, then.
Thankful? What was she doing, climbing trees at her age?
Hattie is young for her age. Perhaps it comes from being by herself so much.
It's beyond me to know what would happen to someone who so stubbornly refuses to grow up.
Hattie will grow up, Mother. She hasn't a choice. None of us do. She'll grow up and she'll marry.
I'll not have her ruling this house when I'm gone.
Oh, Mother, please.
You and Hubert and Edgar are all grown now and in your father's business. You're independent. But if any of you think of marrying Harriet, never, ever expect a penny from me.
Tom, come through slowly. I want to see how it's done.
It's a knack.
I wish I could do that.
How are you?
Oh, I'm quite well. The doctor says the scar won't show.
You had a visitor just now?
Yes. Cousin James. He says I should do other things besides falling out of trees.
Things without me?
Oh, no, Tom. You can come whenever you want to. I count on it. I depend on it.
You have bars on your windows.
It was a nursery once. Don't be so sad, Tom. Shall I show you something? A secret.
I'd like that.
Father long ago.
You used to say they were king and queen.
Cousin James said I shouldn't say things like that anymore, and so I shan't.
Cousin James says a great many things that seem to take away the fun. I have to go now. I'll see you tomorrow.
You always say that, and then it's months and months before I see you again.
But I come every night.
Tom, I'm afraid it's time for me to grow up.
I'll never get back. Aunt Gwen! Uncle Alan!
Mm-hmm. Sleep well, Miss Hattie.
It was awful, Peter. I was trapped in the past with Hattie. In the end, I returned to now, but I don't know how I did it. It's almost as if Hattie, somehow, helped me to get back. I think the clock holds a clue, so I need to get back to the garden and to Hattie. That's really all I want.
Well, Tom, you must be saying goodbye to you soon.
When?
On Saturday. I just had a letter from your mother.
This Saturday?
We're both going to miss you, Tom.
We could hardly expect to keep you with us any longer. Unless we adopted you.
If you adopt me?
I was only joking, Tom.
It's gone rather chilly. Shall I plug the fire in?
Oh, yes.
So much thinner.
I'm no such thing. Aunt Gwen weighed me yesterday.
No, I didn't mean that. I meant thinner through. No, I didn't mean that either. Or rather...
I thought we could look at the clock today to see what the book says the angel's holding.
Could we wait? Must you know now? I'd much rather skate.
Oh, all right.
I'm getting ever so much better. They all say so.
Who's all?
Why, James and Edgar and Hubert. And our new friend, Barty. Don't you like skating, Tom?
I do, yes, but I'd much rather find out what the clock says, what the picture means.
All right. It must be very quiet. Aunt is upstairs. Thank you.
time no longer. But no longer than what? Tell me, Hattie.
Perhaps it means when the last trump sounds and the end of the world comes. Sometimes, Tom, it doesn't do to ask so many questions. Are you coming to the pond with me, Tom, to watch me skate?
No, I must think.
This is a point in time. Now, imagine a painter standing in a landscape and painting it. Imagine a second painter coming up behind him and painting the same landscape with the first painter's picture of the landscape in it. Then, imagine yet a third painter coming up and painting the same landscape with the first painter's picture of the landscape and with the second painter's picture of the first painter's picture of the landscape. And so forth, painter. Fifth. I hope this parallel has made things clearer to you.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Uncle Alan.
Well, let's look at it another way. Think of Rip Van Winkle.
No, actually, that's not very illuminating.
No, think of another point in time, which we'll call point A.
You might say that different people have different times, although, of course, they're all really bits of the same big time.
That would be implying that...
So that I might be able, for some reason, to step back in someone else's time in the past, or she might step forward into my time, which would seem the future to her, although, to me, it would seem the present.
It would be much clearer to go back to this point, eh?
Whichever way it is, she'd be no more a ghost in the past than I'd be a ghost from the future. We're neither of us ghosts, and the garden isn't either. That settles that. You've been very helpful.
What settles what? Gardens? Ghosts? We're talking of theories here.
But Uncle Alan, suppose someone really had stepped out of one time into another. Just like that. It would be proof.
Proof? Apparently I've been able to explain very little to you if I haven't even conveyed to you that proof in matters of time theory. Proof.
Just coming, James.
It's been a pleasure. Oh, James, maybe you answered.
Tom, I'm so glad to see you. I miss you. Even now, in spite of the cousins being so much nicer. And Barty. And skating. Oh, Tom, skating. I feel as if I could go from here to the end of the world. I want to go far. So far. Tom, why haven't you skates?
Hattie, where do you keep your skates? When you're not using them, I mean.
In the boot cupboard in the hall.
Will you promise me something?
I can't promise anything that's wrong or dangerous. No tree climbing.
No. I only want you to promise me to keep your skates in the secret place you showed me. In the bedroom wardrobe, under the floorboards.
Why should I keep them there?
Oh, please promise. I know it sounds silly. That place is still secret, isn't it?
The only person I ever told was you. I don't understand why you want me to, but I'll keep them there. I promise. Tom! That promise means I'd have to leave the skates behind altogether if I ever went away from here.
Thank you. To whomever may find this, these skates are the property of Harriet Melbourne. But she leaves them in this place in fulfillment of a promise she once made to a little boy. Harriet Melbourne, June 2018.
Looking your old self again. Now, the doctor says you can take a walk with me in the park tomorrow.
Is there a card from Tom?
No, nothing today. But you'll see him soon enough. He's coming home the day after tomorrow. Oh, poor boy. He must have had a dreadfully dull time of it.
I wasn't sure if it were you or a trick of the frostlight.
Of course it's me.
I hope so. Look. James is going to market in Castleford this morning and I'm going with him to skate to Ely. Come with us, Tom.
Without going through the garden? I don't know if I can.
Of course you can. The garden will always be there, waiting for you.
Ready, Harriet?
You again.
What are we going to do with that man? He keeps talking to himself.
I'll be no longer than now. If we miss each other, Harriet, you'll need to take the train.
Shall we climb the tower top?
Yes.
Harriet.
586 steps.
5 minutes. 5 minutes until last descent.
Mr. James Robinson, gentleman of the city, who exchanged time for eternity.
The garden where you and Hattie play.
The garden's over there. And Hattie's here. She's the one carrying skates.
That's not Hattie. That's a grown-up woman.
Time, time. Time to go down now, if you please, ladies and gentlemen.
But she's grown up. How can you play with someone who's grown up?
Yes, look. Come along, my dear.
Who is he, Tom? Was he?
Come on, lady. Time, time.
He's my brother, Hattie. He's real. Like me.
Bloody hell.
Miss Hattie?
Barty! I'm so glad to see you.
Where are you off to all alone this evening?
She's not alone, as a matter of fact.
James brought me into town. I'm just after the train for home.
Well, I have my carriage here. Might I give you a lift?
Hattie, wouldn't you rather...
So you like skating?
Yes. More than anything.
You could go next week, if you like. To Castleford or Liverpool. If you like.
We'd love to. Hattie, wouldn't you like to go into the garden? Hattie, don't you see me? Don't you hear me? Please don't walk through me. Hattie, please don't walk through me.
Thank you.
Perhaps you should wake him.
Yes. A boy his age needs 10 hours sleep, not 12.
Not this time.
What is it?
Not now.
Oh, you're awake. It's morning. Oh, you've been in a nightmare. It's over now. It's over now.
Alan. It's time for Tom's sake that he went home. He's terribly strung up. Bad dreams, nightmares. I wouldn't be surprised if he's even walking in his sleep.
I have to get Hattie back, Peter, the way she was. I have a feeling that if I make one last trip into the garden, Hattie might be a little girl again, and we can play games together once more. I want that so much. I want time to go back. I'm telling you this because I might not be home tomorrow as planned. Tonight, I will exchange time for eternity. I'm coming, Hattie. I'll find you in the dark.
Waking up and finding himself standing outside in the dark, all alone. And he was carrying these.
Strange things to carry around, even when sleepwalking. Where did he come by them?
That's what I'd like to know. And he was calling out to someone.
Probably his mother.
No. It was someone else.
It was that old woman.
Mrs. Bartholomew.
Why can't she leave well enough alone?
What did she want?
An apology for the disturbance last night. Of course, I gave her one. I apologized profusely. But she says the boy must go out himself.
That's outrageous. I wouldn't dream of sending him up there.
No, I'll go. I ought to. I don't mind. I don't mind anything now.
Your name is Tom, isn't it?
Yes, my name is Tom. And I've come to apologize.
Tom Long.
I'm sorry about...
You woke me in the middle of the night.
I said I'm sorry.
You called out a name. Tom, you called me. Don't you see? You called me. I'm Hattie.
It's the barometer. That's the barometer from the Melbourne's Hall.
Uh-huh.
And the owl. I don't understand. The garden is gone, and yet all these things are here. You say you were Hattie. Are Hattie?
Yes. I was Hattie. I am Hattie.
What happened after the day we skated to Ely and climbed the tower? The last time we saw each other.
But that wasn't the last time we saw each other, Tom. Have you forgotten? Don't you remember?
That's young Barty.
His name was John Bartholomew. That was taken soon after we married. It was in the year 1895 that we skated to Ely and climbed the tower. We met Barty and he gave us a lift. He told me later that he'd made up his mind that day that he wanted me for his wife. We married a year later. Aunt Melbourne was more than happy to have me off her hands. Midsummer Eve was the eve of my wedding. I was finishing the last of my packing that night. I took what I thought was a last look around the house. Suddenly, and I don't know why, I remembered my skates. And that made me remember you. It had been so long since I'd seen you, but I knew I had to leave them there. In the wardrobe where we'd agreed. I wrote a note to go with them.
I found the note, signed and dated.
In one of the last years of the old century. When the house was being sold, Barty and I came over for the auction. The past I had escaped from, but which was so much part of me, was up for sale. I stood with Barty in front of the mantel in what was once the parlour. In that place where I had stood on Christmas Eve, the night I realised that Barty loved me and that I loved him. The house was already quite different by then. Colder, sadder, emptier. But the clock, our clock was still there, still ticking, still alive. Something that day, some feeling, some vestige of memory, drew me back to what was left of the garden. Somehow I knew that Trixie would survive. Barty sensed that that tree, that place, held a special meaning for me, even though I could never really explain why to him. To know that it was important to me was enough for him. Very much in love, Barty and I stood together beneath Trixie's branches as the world around us continued to change. By the end of that day, there would be just one tree still standing in what was once our garden, Trixie. It's in its very own, very much smaller garden now. I hope whoever owns it takes good care of it.
Did Barty buy the clock for you?
Yes. Barty bought the house and the clock. I'd always loved it, loved to hear it striking.
But you didn't come to live here. Not then.
No. We had a home in the Fens, and we were content there, more than. We had two children. Two boys. They were both killed in the Great War. The First World War, we call it now. And then many years later, Barty died. Peacefully, in my arms. I was left quite alone. And that was when I came here. And I've lived here ever since.
Since you've come here, you've often gone back in time, haven't you? Back into the past.
Oh, yes, Tom. When you're my age, you live in the past. You remember it. You dream it.
These last few nights, you've hardly dreamt about the garden at all.
I dreamt of my wedding and of leaving here.
Last night, I called to you, but I never really thought you would hear me.
You woke me, but I didn't mind. I knew it was Tom calling for help. I couldn't believe you were real.
We're both real, then and now. It's as the pendulum says. Time no longer.
Until the next time, goodbye, Tom.
Goodbye, Hap. Goodbye, Mrs. Bartholomew. Goodbye, Matty.
When he ran up to her and they hugged each other, it was as if they'd known each other for years and years instead of only having met for the first time this morning. And there was something else, Alan. I know you say this sounds even more absurd. Mrs. Bartholomew's an old woman and hardly bigger than Tom, but when he put his arms around her and they hugged each other goodbye, it was as if she were a little girl.